Hi, I am Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram. Welcome to my channel. Thank you for subscribing and turning on the notifications. I appreciate your feedback and your participation in commenting. And do comment, do like the videos if you like them. The last two videos were about infection, an overview of infection, and we focused on airway infections. In this video, we will discuss what we mean by symptomatic treatment of an infection. So when we approach treatment, once we have assessed the child or the parent is assessing the child at home when they are already experienced with managing such problems, you can decide to give symptomatic treatment if the symptoms are bothersome. Specific treatment is indicated if the bacteria is confirmed or if there is a definite sign that there may be a bacterial infection or there is a sign of a serious infection like urinary tract infection or ear infection in a young infant, or the chest infections which can progress to a pneumonia. So when we talk of symptomatic treatment, most of the viral infections need only symptomatic treatment. You may need symptomatic treatment along with the antibiotic for bacterial infections. So we can classify symptomatic treatment into treatment for fever. Fever is one of the commonest manifestations and we have already discussed it in detail in two separate videos. I would refer you to look at those videos as well as the video on management of fever as well. When we talk of other symptoms, we have runny nose, nasal congestion, blocked nose with difficulty in breathing, we may have sore throat, we may have ear pain, and we may have wheezing as a manifestation of the infection or coughing. So symptomatic treatment is only indicated if the symptoms are definitely troublesome and they are only needed on an as needed basis. You don't need to give the symptomatic treatment on a repeated basis. For example, if the child has fever and headache, you give paracetamol for one dose, then you monitor the child. If the fever rises again or the child has increasing sore throat or headache, you can repeat the dose for the pain or the fever symptoms. But if the child is asymptomatic after the first dose, you don't need to really give the medicine again. So we give you the time frame in which you can use. For example, paracetamol can be used every 6 hours, ibuprofen can be used every 8 hours, and so when that time period finishes, if the symptom comes back, you can give that treatment. When we have nasal congestion, normal saline sprays or drops are the mainstay to clear the nose. The disadvantage of this treatment is that it only temporarily relieves for that time. It's a physical clearing mechanism. There is some benefit from hypertonic saline in clearing the virus as well to some extent, or inhibiting the local multiplication. We will discuss the benefits in a separate video. So we have nasal sprays which have mainly saline or hypertonic saline. We also have drops which are easier to use in the younger infants. The main advantage of the saline preparations is the safety. Of course, you shouldn't overuse it beyond the shelf life and you should handle it with care so the tip doesn't get infected. The sprays are slightly more effective because the relief is physical by clearing the infection, the material from the nose. It takes it to the back of the throat. So you're basically moisturizing the area. You're helping the body's own mechanism to move the mucus backward into the airway where we swallow it. And we have nasal decongestants. These are to be used occasionally if the congestion is significant and it's causing problems sleeping. So the nasal decongestants belong to the xylometazoline group of medicines, like pediatric otrivin spray, for example. You shouldn't use it in young infants unless it's medically supervised. In older infants and children, you can consider occasional use at bedtime. Don't use it on a repeated basis. If you use it more than 5 days continuously, it may actually cause rebound congestion. So this is called tolerance to the medicine, and also rebound congestion happens. So the medicine itself causes the vasculature to swell up, which causes the nasal block to increase. So Otrivin type of medicine should not be used on a repeated basis, and you shouldn't use more than 5 days at a time. We have medicines like nasal steroids. I've seen many parents coming in with Nasonex or nasal steroids of that type on a repeated basis. They use it as if it is saline or if it is a symptomatic decongestant. Remember that the nasal steroids are not for short-term relief of symptoms. They are specifically indicated for a condition called allergic rhinitis. where we give it on a repeated basis, on a daily basis for a month or even longer to relieve the congestion, which is a result of nasal allergy. So do not use steroid nasal sprays for symptom relief of acute cold and things like that. It doesn't work. It takes 5 to 6 days to start working in the first place. So please understand why we use a particular medicine and how it helps before you use it on your child on a repeated basis. The other group of medicines is antihistamines. They are notoriously commonly used. They may give a brief symptom relief in the acute stage of the cold when there is sneezing, runny nose, and so on in a significant way. If it's a mild symptom, just the nasal spray should be enough. Using an antihistamine, for example, fenistil drops in babies may cause drowsiness. So avoid using it as best as you can. And some of the antihistamines cause dryness of the secretions, and it makes it more difficult for the natural mechanisms to clear these secretions. So do not use them as a routine. If symptoms are very significant, you may use them. The drowsiness is a side effect, so be careful of the dose, and do not use it in young infants because their mechanisms are not well developed to wake up when they are drowsy, and going into deep sleep may be dangerous, and there is a risk of sudden infant death syndrome. So less than 3 months of age, do not use any medicine that can cause drowsiness, and beyond that age as well, the symptomatic treatment risk benefit has to be considered. Use it only if needed for maybe a dose or two when the symptoms are acute. The cough medicines, of course, we have cough as an irritating symptom, and there is varying schools of thought on whether you need to reduce the cough or not. If there is a bronchitis, for example, you do need to bring out your secretions. The cough is a mechanism to clear the airway, and you don't need to give antitussives in this situation, because suppressing the cough may mean you're retaining the secretions, you're reducing the body's ability to fight the infection. If the cough is from irritation of the throat, like a post-nasal drip, as I mentioned earlier, giving a decongestant briefly might reduce it. If there is allergic rhinitis and it's producing a post-nasal drip and cough, you might benefit from the steroid spray if it's a repeated symptom. If there is wheezing that is produced, we may consider a bronchodilator as a nebulized form or an inhaled form. Even in viral wheeze, some symptom relief may happen from use of bronchodilators in this setting alone. If after a viral infection the child has a repeated chesty cough, most of the time it resolves, but if it disturbs their sleep and it sounds like wheezy cough, you may consider a bronchodilator nebulization. But an oral bronchodilator is not used anymore. It has a higher risk of side effects, and you give a much higher dose than when you give nebulized. So a syrup like Ventol or something is not to be recommended in routine management of colds. So this is an overview, and the cough suppressants are not good medicines in terms of chest infections, so do not use cough suppressants routinely. Expectorants have a limited role if you have significant expectoration. However, if it's just a cough, expectorants don't have. So to be honest with you, cough syrups do not have much value. You may consider treating the cough again like the antihistamines that we mentioned very briefly, and soothing agents, herbal soothing agents can be considered as well to reduce the cough symptom relief. In an older child, lozenges to reduce the throat irritation may reduce the dry cough in the acute part of the cold as well. So this is for symptomatic relief of a cold. If there is a urinary tract infection suspected, you have to give plenty of fluids. In any fever or any situation, hydration is key. Don't allow the child to get dehydrated. Appetite tends to be low. You try to feed what the child tends to take, at least maintain the hydration. There is no harm if the child eats less for a couple of days and then catches up after that. You can give snacks like yogurt, cheese, and also maintain the fruit intake and water intake for the child. However, don't force the sick child to eat. They may vomit as well. If vomiting is a symptom, you may give antiemetics, which I will not discuss now. If dehydration is a risk, you give oral rehydration solutions. This is most important if there is symptoms like diarrhea. We will discuss diarrhea and vomiting separately. So this is to give you an overview of symptomatic treatment mainly related to the upper respiratory tract infections. I hope this video is useful and it helps you. And I request you to subscribe, turn on the notifications if not already done, and do share this with your friends. And I'll see you in the next video soon.